certainly, it gave me the elephant in the corner of the room, to go back and get more angry. I'm not Matt McGehee. It's a pleasure to be here today and speak with all of you. But one of the things that is challenging in any setting, whether it be a workers' compensation setting or general clinical setting, is trying to help patients navigate their way through back injuries. So I kind of divided this up in a couple of different ways, drawing on different experiences that I've had clinically in my practice with Portland. I'll talk a little bit about some of the pathology and pathophysiology related to spinal injuries. Not too much on that. That could be a whole talk or a whole series unto itself. There's no real procedural tilt to this talk either in terms of, you know, contrary to some of my orthopedic colleagues. We're going to focus more on looking at the worker and looking at back pain from the context of their work, and then also trying to help engage in normal, you know, everyday conversations. There's a lot of your clinical practice, whether it be seeing someone for the first time or for the 10th time for their work injury. We'll expand upon that and go through a couple different algorithmic things and I'll give you some information for some guidelines. All that's included in your slides. So I guess I'll get started. One thing briefly about physical medicine and rehabilitation, it's a specialty that integrates all of the different aspects of physical care, but also with attention to quality of life. That's one of the things that's emphasized at our academy, and thinking about return to function as a big marker for that too. So that's a little bit about my personal tilt and the slides. Okay. No disclosures for me. All right. So low back pain in terms of the incidence of it is extremely high. We're all aware of that. It is the leading cause of years lived with disability in developed nations. And if you look at things internationally, there's a lot of studies that look at standardized work or occupational outcomes in Europe, and they feel the same way. But in the United States alone, it's in the billions in terms of the amount of cost related to industrial industries, not necessarily the delivery of healthcare, but more specifically in the loss of productive time and productive hours and services. And as that carries forward, they've studied that collectively, a third of all occupational musculoskeletal injuries and illnesses are from back pain that result in ultimate disability. And I thought Dr. Jacob's slide from the talk earlier on hand and wrist talking about the musculoskeletal injuries, particularly he said back, neck, you know, wrist and upper extremity, that was a huge number from strained sprains all the way through back pain alone. But Bureau of Labor Statistics, they track that and post data tables, which are very dense, but you can look at it if you're interested. It shows you how common this is. So an interesting statistic published in 2014 in the Occupational Environmental Medicine, Journal of Occupational Environmental Medicine looks at rate of returning low back pain in terms of return to work. So this would be a recurring theme as we talk about. Within a month, that's a lot of people. Everybody, you know, they have an injury, they get fully treated, then they'll go back and they'll do their return to work plan of care, and it's successful. So a smaller percentage, you know, about 17% of these cases experience disability for 1 to 6 months. And then a smaller percentage yet, the 7% of cases hit that greater than 6 month mark. I think that can't be emphasized enough, particularly as we're going through evaluating and treating our patients, our primary care providers, our patient medicine group providers, and people on the front line and talk to patients about expectations for this. The longer the length of disability in low back pain, the longer the higher the likelihood of permanent disability. So as we think about this, take that into consideration. Spine care, I'm going to keep these anatomy slides really, really brief, but I'd rather make sure that we emphasize how we can work through those. But this is a really simple diagram with the cervical spine, thoracic spine, our ribs coming along here, defining our thoracic limb. We have 5 non-ribbon lumbar segments and our few sacral vertebrae. The majority of our low back pain, obviously, stems from some type of injury, whether it be to the bony anatomy itself, to the soft tissue overlying that, to the ligaments, to the muscles, and how to explain that to the patient. I like to describe this as layers of an onion, if you would. You think about it, you have this deepest layer with the spine, the support structure, or a totem pole is another description that I often use in terms of describing the way that you have this pillar of force and going down towards the low back. And that greatly is affected by stresses. Now, if you look at this in cross-section too, you see you've got all the way, this is the posterior aspect here, your pubic body anteriorly. This right here is about the upper portion of the lumbar spine. You can see the very distal end of the thumb terminal and the spinal cord and all the individual nerves making up across the posterior spine. And the ligamental structures, the interspinous ligament, the ligamental platelet, all these things are potentially affected with an injury. Then you talk about the set joint lines and such. But as you go through, that's all outside of the nerve root. Which everyone is going to think about lumbar spine, you have nerve root impingement. Well, there's so many other factors that relate to the pathology of that in addition to the nerve root. So here's a real nice, Mars, this is another netter picture here, but with the bone removed to expose the individual pieces, there's a lot of individual segmental potential for nerve root irritation as you go down through there. Yes. And you can see how all of that comes down each level, segmental level, working its way down to the lumbar plexus, dimensions, the sacral plexus. You see how each one of those can potentially be affected unto itself. Now, how does that carry over in terms of looking at that? As you mentioned, the emotional side, it's an anatomical side that I've loved since I did an Abby group in residency. But as you go down, you can see the spinal cord, and as the spinal cord gets smaller, you're left at each level. It's like I described as it's an elevator when I'm describing to patients and looking at how at every floor of the elevator, two nerves exit. And then by the time you get down towards the bottom, the elevator is empty. But you can see there's more and more room within that. Along with that room, it's playing positional things in terms of, oh, if I go just kind of like this, if I kind of take my weight off of my leg and I lay down and I curl over this way, I can make my sciatica go away. I'm like, well, yes, because it's a motion-based environment, and also the potential for there being central disc pushing on a nerve, you can find a comfortable position that will help you relieve those symptoms. And so when you think about it along that line, it's they're moving parts. So this goes back to a little bit of the bone and the ligamental aspect of things too. This is a kind of a mirror image. So the one on the left side of the screen here looks at the bony anatomy of the spine, taking into consideration just the vertebral bodies and their vertebral discs. You have the central canal, set capsules, set joint lines, and the ligamental structures that lie in between. This picture on the right side looks at those pain-sensitive tissues within that functional unit, trying to help us as we're looking through it. These are kind of mirror images for the posterior aspect of the spinal process is here and here. This is the anterior, and that's the anterior. The nerve root, obviously, that's a plus, and that's one thing that has nociceptors in the pain-sensitive tissue. Now, if we look at the vertebral body, yes, obviously, bone, we're familiar with how that can collapse. We'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. But ligamentally, you can see all of these individual structures. Set our joint capsule and the cartilaginous surface there. All of the structures have the potential to be nociceptors. Now, the intervertebral disc, this is listed as negative in this study. I've got some information to the contrary there too as well, but if you look at it, it can be a whole variety of things related to that. And this doesn't even include soft tissue, doesn't include the way that the musculature and fascial planes can become involved when you have a back injury. So postural movements play a big part of this. Paraspinal muscle and core position, core strength, and the ability of that to hold your line so that you can feel adequate body support with activity. The risk of injury depends on your specific repetitive movement. Now this is the one where I had some slides earlier that went through all these different repetitive movements, and I was like, if I go over this, you can injure your back 500 ways. There's no standardized way to injure your back. If you're in a chronic seated position, doing something with the upper extremities, you can develop a back pain from just being in that seated position for too long. Same thing with lifting carry or carry twist, or you're plugging in blood nuts, whatever you're doing, you can hurt your back. And that's one of the reasons why we rely so heavily on our colleagues who help us with the rehabilitation side of that, because we need to know what the injured worker does and what the injured worker does to help us understand how we can help them change their pathology, change the trajectory of their healing. So the risk of injury depends specifically on the repetitive movement. And that is where the provider interaction with the patient begins, because you need to know, how did you sustain this injury? And it can be 50% of what you do on a day-to-day basis that causes 100% of your pain. So axial lumbar pain, just breaking down into subsections, myofascial pain, segmental dysfunction, or relative instability, facet-mediated pain, sacroiliac joint-mediated pain, or intradiscal pain. Those are just going through. If you look through, that's, as you could talk about, all those would be a multi-hour talk unto itself in terms of looking at the way that we evaluate and treat those things. However, think about it on the individual level when you're going down with the patient and going through your exam findings. And we'll talk about some of those things in the afternoon session about how to differentiate each of those. So this is not the interventional treatment talk, so I just put those up here just for our singular slide, treatment injections, soft tissue injections, proliferative therapy injections, interventional treatments, radio frequency neuropathy, SI joint injections, referral spirit injections are all things that are done from the procedural side to help patients. But the key thing for those, that's the last slide I'll have up there as it relates to that, is that the whole point of doing procedural care is to facilitate one's participation with rehabilitation. And that needs to be abundantly clear with the person who's receiving that treatment. It's not a cure-all for that treatment. It's designed to help them jumpstart their recovery. And if their recovery is slowed for a variety of reasons, or whenever you see them, you say, all right, we can certainly work with conservative care, but there are things that can potentially help you. Just turn down the amount of discomfort that you're having and get you going from a rehab standpoint. So facets, or the zygomaticomastoideal joints, if they have a dual innervation, this branch comes down from the previous supraspinal nerve, and also branch comes up from the inferior nerve, so that they have a dual innervation here. That's one of the things that is important in terms of targeting and looking at how to address those. Those treatments can be intra-articular or looking at the innervation to that joint and utilizing, increasing that innervation to facilitate. So intervertebral disc structure, now I think that there's a lot that's said about physical injuries and looking at how the disc responds to axial loads, but a brief anatomical primer here. The outer layer of the annulus is preventing the bulging of the inner tissue, and it's important in terms of stability. You know, these are concentric circles going around, but then they're having anatomical features which go alternating directions on the tendon-free planes. And all of the different lamellae inside of that annular ring are important. If you have a defect in any part of that, that can lead to a point of weakness. The annular annulus is less dense. It allows for deformation and helps dissipate some of the pressure that you see through the nuclear level. Now, that nuclear level, we'll turn right to the center there. It's mostly type 2 collagen and protein glycans. It's somewhat liquidy. It's described a lot of different ways, but sometimes I describe that as center of a grape, or if you imagine something that has a little bit some substance to it, but also has a high water content. As those cells, in terms of how they change, in terms of looking at the organization to the type 2 collagen that is on the outside, it has more of a random organization than the type 1 annulus. So I talk a little bit more about if you're looking at end plate changes, and we see this when we look at reports that talk about degenerative changes on the end plate and end plate thickening. We also see reports of descriptive of Schmerl zones and how the change that you can see at the level of the cortex of the end plate can lead to relative instability and relative increase in pressure in that area. So, look, if you look through here, this is kind of a blown-up picture right through here on this logical, just a somatic level. You have a lot of vasculature that comes up and plays a role in input health. Now, this would get into the commentary that they had on that earlier slide that said, okay, the intradiscal component of it is not really a pain generator per se, because the lack of vessels and structures to go into the actual center of this material. And so when we look at this, we see the venous flow, the arterial flow down towards the inflator, a very important portion of that, particularly their supply for the thin layer of cartilage-producing cartilaginous cells right here. And that capillary supply to that area is important as you're looking at degradation or change. Now, someone could have a change of that that's age appropriate, but then they have an injury or something, or a load response, or an injury to the bone that plays a role in that. There's more and more. If you look at this as a microtrauma and nerve destruction and possible pain as a result of microtrauma or implant separation. There's a lot of phases, a lot of basic science that looks into this. And you can feel free to look at this and look at these references too. But multi-phase disruption of the implant related to degenerative changes can contribute towards advancing what you see, the implant fibrosis and the changes that leads ultimately to early disc failure. This was an interesting basic science study that I learned about probably over 10 years now. But when you think about the end plate and again this vessel change and the aging process that happens related to spinal health, you can see dramatic changes in the physiologic vessels of the end plate leading to structural alterations in that cartilaginous plate, and then you start seeing an increase in the cellular depth, and that can go and work its way into that tubal body change there too. So this looks at inflammatory changes. This is a schematic as well, but if you're thinking about interdiscal changes or fissures in that annulus fibrosis causing increased discomfort, its innervation only goes in a certain percentage. It doesn't go all the way towards the center, but it's an important percentage as it relates to that load bearing change and also its effects on inflammation on the basic nerve tissue. I'd like to look specifically at how these changes affect your load bearing and an acute change and some of the changes that you see on advanced imaging when you're trying to work up discogenic pain. But how much of that plays a role in terms of how much earlier changes in their integrity of the bone and soft tissue is important as we look forward to as well. So I've got one of the things that is key that centers around how we devise up the care plan for these is looking at where someone's feeling some of the discomfort and then how those distal changes can carry forward in terms of presenting pain. Now, this is a chart that's also in your handout here, and it's relative to central and lateral recess changes, which is we all would think, okay, L4-5 disc, you have an L4 nerve coming out of the frame, and it's along those lines. But often, when you have to divide these up into these zones, as you're reading these reports, and the central zone and the lateral recess can affect the descending nerve roots as they travel through that area. So when you're evaluating and reading a study and they make a comment on, well, the exiting L5 nerve root looks adequate, but say there is a paracentral bulge or a central zone bulge that affects a nerve root here, it is a potential pain generator for patients. If you look at the disc that you think should be involved in, it's not really that nerve is affected. For example, this hypothetical descending L5 nerve root here would come out of the frame that the L5/S1 opening, but that looks fine. L5/S1 disc looks great. So just kind of going through, just being aware of the way that where the disc herniations are located can affect how the presentation of your pain condition. So now moving on to kind of best practice ideas concepts related to our effects on getting workers back. There are best practice recommendations. I'll review a couple of them, but all of these kind of give us some ideas and are the center for creative practice. Now, this came out in 2007. It was Roger Chow, who is OHSU based, a multi-center, multi-group review I'll fly through these next few slides because I'm most interested in making sure that people have the guidelines in hand and they can review them independently. But so, general recommendation number one, physicians could conduct a public history and physical examination. Okay, that's kind of pretty basic. But back pain associated with you have this broad category is non-specific back pain with involved stenosis or back pain associated with another spinal cause. And then early on, they really do emphasize, you know, starting to look at psychosocial risk factors, which predict the risk for chronic disabling back pain. I fully agree with that. Acute management, so look at your red flags, and then NSAIDs, relative rest, I would put rehabilitation on there early on, just kind of getting people up and going and trying to move. And identify patients at risk for chronic pain. You can start that as early as you'd like. If you know someone who has been, if you're a primary care doctor and you've been coach treated for depression and they come in for an acute injury, it's something that to certainly be on the radar. Red flags, progressive neurological deficits, chronic myna, osteoporosis risk, cancer risk, constitutional symptoms, immunosuppression, we can look up at these infection risks. And then also systemic causes. These are medical issues that should also be on the uninsured differential if it doesn't quite make sense between an injury and how it's presenting for the patient. So, longer for spinal conditions. So, if you're thinking about identifying on acute things that will become more of a problem, if you're dealing with a radiating pain situation where there is some type of progression of that initial pain outside of the back, now it's going down into the leg or it's going down into the thigh or the foot, be mindful of that. Physical demands of work, and asking them how they go through their job, if they're doing work-related compensation things, job satisfaction, income satisfaction, and then psychological factors too as well. So our rebel signs in terms of looking on evaluation things that are consistent, and that's a very common question. Are the findings consistent with what we examined? So, recommendations. They, in this group, did recommend looking at imaging early on and performing diagnostic testing as it became more persistent.
When you're present in your workforce and you're present and you're looking at direct costs versus indirect causes, presenteeism, or the concept of someone that's present at work but isn't able to work up to their fullest, is an important concept to mention. Because the cost relative to having someone who is missing work, seeking out good medical care that's definitive, it's much larger in terms of relative loss, and that's looking at published data points. And how that takes into consideration is that the top of the pyramid, the folks who have higher incidence of direct medical costs and looking at where those compensation group come in, they're the smallest portion in terms of looking at the majority of the dollars are spent, and kind of people are in the middle who are present, who are at work but aren't necessarily working up to the highest level, and that's lower productivity relative to that risk factor too. And then a good portion right in through here is our low risk population who are treated early on and get back to work in a quick manner. This is an excellent reference, and I'll make reference to this text. And if you have a chance to add it to your library, particularly if you're seeing people who are in the workplace and sustaining an injury, it's tackling musculoskeletal problems, a guide for the clinic and the workplace, and identifying flags. We'll talk briefly about that. Developing your plan and taking action. This was published almost 10 years ago now, but it really is a very helpful user-friendly guide in terms of looking at the person, their workplace, and the context in which you're looking at those evaluations and those treatment plans. And that to me is really an important factor, because those obstacles may not be obstacles that you specifically are able to directly identify until you think about the worker within their context. So we'll review some of that, and I think it'll be helpful to kind of take it step by step, but the person, the workplace, and the context is how this is devised. The biopsychosocial model, which we've all heard, but I don't know, all of us use it every day, but it's an important concept to go through that too as well. So in the concept of the timeline for these things, you have it in stepped care. You need to deliver the care that it's at the time of the injury relative to the individual pieces. And I'll break these up on a subsequent slides, but looking at under 2 weeks, getting your supportive care, setting symptom control and providing good advice for the patient is very important. All the way back out to 6 months later when you're trying to find a larger problem and identifying those problems to help them navigate their way through this process. So good evidence-based advice, symptom control, busting through the myths that you're never gonna get better. Light intervention, helping patients and helping them ways through healthcare processes and identifying those psychosocial obstacles. Shifting forward, stopping things that aren't working is important when you identify several weeks out, and that's the time if you are gonna make specialty care referrals, thinking about those things. Revisiting your plan and really kind of kicking it into a multidisciplinary effect, certainly by that 3 month mark. Maximizing your return to work and play efforts by all players, reaching out, trying to talk to claims managers, trying to find out, is there anything that we can help do to help move these forward? At this point, you're really looking at that small percentage, and that's what this graph represents here. The patients initially, who are not recovered or returned to work yet, obviously early on it's everyone because they're being treated, but the further you get out, 12 weeks, greater than 12 weeks, the people who are not recovered yet, it's a very small number, but this is probably where we spend the majority of our time if we're looking at long-term disability in terms of how to get them moving forward to understand that steps. So going through those myths and understanding how the patient works through that, I think this is important too. You cannot return to work until you're 100% pain-free. That's a big misnomer in terms of how someone will go through that. And time off work is needed as part of the treatment. No, not necessarily. Depends on what you're doing and how that works through the process. So I'm going to go through these very, very quickly, but catastrophizing, expectation, preoccupation with health, worry and distress, these are the things that your patients and your injured workers are going to be primarily thinking about. Fear of movement or re-injury is so important as you're going through and helping identify a problem. Uncertainty, also serial but ineffective therapy. If someone has done this, they say, I've been to PT. I'd like you to go back to PT. I've been to PT. It's how you go through and identify, well, what were you doing? Take the extra step to get your hands on some old PT notes to see if you can help them navigate through that process. So I'm gonna fly through some of these so I had these individually. But this is an important slide too as well that you can use in the clinic as well. Finding out screening for depression and how you can go about doing that in an efficient manner. This study looked at PHQ-9, which is a very simple test that is a patient health questionnaire, helps look at depression. And they're basically, their conclusion was that the percent people who are screening positive on PHQ-9 and their relative poor work performance as measured objectively in this study, there was a direct correlation between the two. The work groups with a high level of depression, they were performing poorly on the job. So there were subsequent studies that looked at how that can be measured if you're monitoring for depression. I can give someone your reference for this after. It was published in Spine Journal in 2014, and they looked at what was the best test for depression screening in your spinal patients. And PHQ-9 and Beck Depression Inventory, and the Beck Depression Inventory is really heavy mental, that kind of mental health weighted, were the two that measured within 21 questions and 9 questions respectively, as well as one would have in terms of looking at the DSM-4 criteria for measuring for major depressive disorder. So if you have access to PHQ-9 and Beck Depression Inventory, those are great. Short form 36, I don't know how many of you guys use those in your practice, but those are, it's another functional measure that looks at physical questions of physical health and then also of mental health. So collectively, you want to find all those individual pieces together and then measure them out so that you can have an objective way of helping identify some of these red flags. So in the workplace, you can look at it from an employer and an employee standpoint. The employee, we've talked about kind of fear of re-injury, negative expectation of recovery and return to work, their job satisfaction. And if they have low social support or dysfunction at the home or in the workplace, that's really important. But this part here as well is equally important. I'll kind of jump forward to that, looking at where the employer and the employee interact. Are there aspects of that job that the employee finds difficult? And are those aspects of that job identifiable? And is something that you can talk to an employer about potentially? Now, navigating the way between representing an injured worker in a work comp claim with talking with their employer or talking with the lawyer who represents their employer, I think it's healthy, provided that there's full disclosure amongst your team managers and then the patient endorses someone talking about it. You're not disclosing medical history or breaking, you know, the line that we have in terms of confidentiality, but you are in a situation where your goal is trying to help them get back to work as effectively as you can. So, you know, I review all the time job analysis that look at policies and procedures for particular jobs, and those come from the employers or from the vocational counselors directly. Liking to focus on what the person can do is important too as well. So asking even that person, what can you do? And then maybe just ask, you know, kind of translating that, what would you like to talk to your supervisor about in terms in order to return working? That's a very simple question that you can ask your injured worker in office to try to navigate your way through the complexities of return to work. So, all right. One other thing is communication. This question here, have the employer made contact in stopping work? And the answer oftentimes is no, they don't talk. And there isn't that healthy interaction, that dialogue that can commonly be helpful as you're helping someone move forward in their claim. I can't tell you how many times folks will look at, if I talk to my employer about what I can and can't do, that means that I'm gonna lose my job because they think that I'm not gonna be able to go back and do that job. Or I can't go back and do the specific job that I want to do. Well, most of the time, if someone's been with an employer for a number of years, they value them as an employee, and they're having to retrain someone to do a job, and they may be able to find something where they can help out and train someone who can fill in. But then the employee thinks, oh, well, I'm training my replacement. And when I'm training my replacement, my job is now in jeopardy because I'm training someone else to do that specific skill that I knew how to do, and I got pretty good at. So having open communication and letting someone know, or even to the best of your ability, involving the claims manager and involving the employer-employee communication is very important, because sometimes it just takes that little bit of doubt in someone's mind to think that they're not going to be have full disclosure with you, and that may roll over into clinical care as well. The context in which the person functions, think about that at home and in the workplace. Obviously, secondary gain things are things that we try to work out. We see that quite a bit. And low back pain. I don't know how many of you guys have to watch video surveillance on injured workers. I do it quite often when and that's real. I'm not telling you that because that's very real, where the Department of Labor and Industry or employer or the managed care organization will pay a private detective and they'll surveil your patients for, I don't know, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. They'll summarize it in a nice 1 hour segment and they'll give it to me to watch. And ask that how that relates to my exam. And I'm like, oh my gosh, okay. Talk about putting me on the spot. But it helps in some cases. There's some cases where I see somebody going into the dump and unloading like a huge, you know, truck full of things that aren't featherweight. And you get a pretty good sense, okay. Or bending over situationally, you have to be careful. It's a fine line. But if it's something that's pretty egregious, then you can comment on it. But if it's something that it's like, well, yeah, sure, they could maybe bend over and pick up their five-year-old one time flexing at the waist, but in the office they can only flex 20 degrees. And you're trying to figure out, well, I'm a parent. I'm going to pick up my five-year-old if he's crying. I'm going to bear, you know, grit through it, and I'm going to do it. But if that's on tape, then that can be used against that injured worker to prove that their range of motion is not 10 degrees. So it's hard, but it's very true. So think about it in that context. history of claims and previous claims and history of extended prior time loss are things that they're also looking at, and you should be aware of. Asking someone, do they have a previous injury? Is this something you've had hurt before, or are there any other injuries before? So in terms of how we can find the best modalities for patients, having reasonable expectations, these are the key questions. What do you think has caused the problem? What do you expect is going to happen? How are you coping with things? Is it getting you down? When do you think you'll get back to work? And what can be done at work to help? One other quick anecdote. I have a patient who did an interdisciplinary rehabilitation program for several months, did really, really well in that interdisciplinary program, got back up to a heavy lifting capability, was ready to go back to work. He worked for a commercial furniture and electronics rental place. So somebody would rent furniture and then he'd go deliver it. This injured worker had some spinal issues that were pre-existing, but they were pretty stable, and had been told early on by myself, all right, we had a bunch of studies and we saw these spinal problems. So despite that, he was able to very successfully navigate through a work conditioning and work hardening program and was cleared. I got a job analysis, I read it, I was like, okay, that'll work. And I sent him back and he did not want to go back to work because I told him that, you know, he had a spondylolysis that was present, likely pre-existing. And we had some things we had just to be mindful of it and just did some education about that. There's a lot of people who have that condition. But, you know, it kind of, that person, I don't think will ever go back to the employer despite, you know, an extensive amount of resources being dedicated to that person's recovery, because they were worried potentially about how that other injury would help them or would prevent them from going back to work. That's just one example, but this person's now, you know, 28 years old and thinks that they're not gonna be able to work. And I consider that a real challenge to all of us to try to help educate patients on what it is that will help them get back to work. And even under controlled circumstances, they were able to lift, you know, independently 70, 80, 100 pounds, still didn't feel like they were ready. That was the barrier that had been in place. I want to end with this. This is a paper that, you know, I actually found pretty late as I was preparing this talk, but the full reference is right there. And it is a fantastic overall evaluation for helping patients with medical conditions stay at work and return to work, and Journal of Occupational and Environmental Medicine. It's a position statement, it's a summary statement, it goes through how do you navigate the way through. You know, just looking at the high points, also they're one of the big recommendations is following evidence-based practice. But promptly addressing the causality of the injury, just, you know, letting people know, just like I was just describing, was this a work injury or is this not a work injury? Is this a combined condition? Is this something that they'll help them get better? Identifying and minimizing delays, picking up the phone and calling a claims manager, you know, reaching out, trying to make sure that someone has the effective treatment that they can receive and streamlining that. And then activity prescriptions for function at home and at work. Activity prescriptions are sometimes challenging if you're not really familiar with what they're doing. Try to get your hands on a job analysis as soon as possible. That means reaching out as soon as you establish care with an injured worker and calling that claims manager so that you can say, hey, can you talk to the employer about getting me a job analysis so I can know what was the job and injury, what was the strength rating for that job and injury, and is there a job analysis available? Oftentimes there is not, or they have not had a functional JA created for this position that person was doing. It could be they got hurt doing something completely different. You know, motor vehicle accident, driving from work site A to work site B, but their job requires them to lift heavy independently. So trying to get that information so that you can translate that into successful treatment. All right, I am out of time. I appreciate your attention, and thank you very much.